Hello there, welcome to Snack Verse. Today we're reading Romans chapter 12, verse 16, the Amplified Bible. Live in harmony with one another. Do not be haughty, snobbish, high-minded, exclusive, but readily adjust yourself to people, things, and give yourselves to humble tasks. Never overestimate yourself or be wise in your own conceit. This is a very interesting portion of scripture, and I could tell you a whole lot about it, but I'll just say two or three things real quick, and then I'll tell you a story. Number one, this is Paul's letter to the Romans, and he's writing to them, telling them about how Christians should be with one another. This is the logos. This is applicable to everybody. This is true, and this is the word of God. Now, the beautiful thing is that when you have a walk with God, God can lead you with the Bible, with the Word of God, in circumstances and situations where a scripture comes alive to you in a very personal and unique way. And I want to tell you a story about this scripture and how it happened to me, so that perhaps you will understand a bit how the Word of God leads in a deeper way that is still consistent, right, with what is written. Now, we call this unique leading. A lot of times we call it rhema. And this is what happened. So I got a call from a mentor of mine, and she wanted me to do something for her. She wanted me to represent her to do a job, but she didn't want the people I was going to work for to know she was the one sending me. Now, she's very influential, she's highly placed, very accomplished, very successful. And this is a difficult client, and for some reason she thinks I could get the job done. And there was no time. So she calls me up on a Friday morning to go do a meeting on a Friday evening for a task I was going to execute on Saturday. There was no time. And so when I hung up from that call, she means a lot to me, so I couldn't say no. The first thing I did was to just go quiet, go calm, and I just spoke to God. I need to do this, and I don't know what to do. What do I need to know? And somehow in that season, I was reading Romans. And so I just felt, you know, impressed to go and flip through Romans, right? And I was just flipping through. Now, you need to know how God leads you, how God speaks to you. So I could tell that this was the Holy Spirit leading me. And already I was happy because I knew that if I had instruction, I was going to get the job done. And so I got to this point, and, you know, it made a strong impression on me. So I took note of it. And the first thing that I felt was like, okay, you're going in there like a very humble person. The person that sent you, she's big, she's influential, she's all of that, but you are not. Right now, you are nobody. So you go there with the disposition that you are nobody. You know, so it even that mindset dictated what I wore. It dictated the courage with which I went in for that meeting. And I got there. The executive that I met, in reality, she's way younger than me. But I went there, yes, ma'am, no, ma'am, three bags full, ma'am, we'll do whatever you want. I catered to her. She was a bit condescending, nose in the air, even though she needed me. The first mistake I made was that in the negotiation, I was supposed to collect 100% upfront because there was no time. But because I was trying to impress, because I was trying to please, I allowed her to give me whatever amount. I beg your pardon. I allowed her to give me whatever amount she was willing to part with. Right? That was fine. And so I left there at 11 p.m. in the night, that meeting. And I got into a bit of trouble on the Third Milan Bridge coming back home. But the driver that was driving me was a very wise person, and God saw us through. And I got home. And the first thing I did was to pick my phone, and begin to mobilize the people that were going to help me to get the job done. I didn't sleep. After doing all of that, I spent time praying and just thanking God for how it was going to be. I got up early the next day with a cup of tea, and I went off to the location of the assignment. It was tough. It was stressful. Everything that could go wrong was trying to go wrong, but I held it together. The first time I remembered that scripture was when some of the people that were going to work with me were running late. I didn't say because I was the boss or the leader of the crew. I rolled up my sleeves, I got in there, got my hands dirty, got the job done with them. You couldn't tell who was the boss and who was, you know, the people that were doing the work, because I just got in there. We didn't have time. We were working, you know, behind time, and I was under pressure to make sure that the people I was doing things for were going to be happy and were going to give me back my balance, right? And so that was it. By the time our job was done, I was looking for my contact person and I couldn't find her. It was obvious I was doing the job and she was dodging me because she didn't have money to pay. I didn't leave there until about 2:11 in the night. While my job was done, my money wasn't forthcoming. There were many things I could do, right? And then I came home and I was angry. I was angry because at a certain point, my contact person told me the money she was going to give me, she had to spend it doing something that in my own opinion was just nonsense. But what did I do? I came home. First of all, I thanked God that the job was done and I didn't disgrace the person that sent me. But I wanted my money. I wanted my money. And then that scripture rang true in my head again. That in going after my money, I shouldn't play the card of, do you know who I am? I can call the police. I can sue you. I will call my lawyers. I knew that that was what that scripture meant. That I'm supposed to humble myself to do menial tasks. I did that by joining the laborers to do the work, to arrange things, to set things up. The scripture that talked about not being high-minded, I kept telling this girl, yes ma, okay ma, I hear you ma, I'm sorry ma, okay ma, we'll do. I kept doing all of that. I'm certain I can't be anything less than 13 to 15 years older than this lady. But that was the instruction I was given, and that was what I did, right? And I catered to her, went over and beyond. Another portion of it was to adjust myself. I adjusted myself to the kind of people I met there, spoke Pidgin when I was supposed to speak Pidgin, spoke English when I was supposed to speak English. I made all the adjustments. And now it was time for my money. And I felt that I shouldn't, you know, and now this part was, don't be wise in your own conceit. So ordinarily what somebody would say, look, I know, I've done my job, I'm on my rights, I will call my lawyers, I would sue you, I didn't do all of that. I kept sending mail, and all through the very next day, the Monday, she told me that the person that was going to sign my check was not around. I was angry. I kept praying. I said, God, the Bible says that God opposes the proud but gives grace to the humble. I humbled myself on this job, right? And so the grace that is mine, you know, I'm asking for it now, right? And a friend of mine sent me a scripture. I called her and I told her, this was my experience. This was happening. I want my money. She sent me a scripture that is what comes to her mind, that it will not exact upon me, right? I called another friend. I told her what happened. She sent me another scripture. Sometimes I'll lie down, I'll sleep, I'll get up, I'll pace my room again. I say, Lord, I want my money. I want my money. They are not doing me a favor. Whoever it is that is supposed to sign this check, Lord, cause them to rise up. Let them, by whatever motivation, let them send, you know, my money. In the night, I couldn't sleep. And I'm like, Lord, I can't sleep. And I mentioned the person's name. This person shouldn't be able to sleep. The same way the king, King Ahasuerus, couldn't sleep because Mordecai, in the story of Esther, they hadn't done what was supposed to be done for Mordecai for doing something good. The king couldn't sleep until the books were brought. And he called for a reward of honor to be given to Mordecai. And I said, Lord, the person that's supposed to sign my money out shouldn't be sleeping. Shouldn't be sleeping because I can't sleep. You know? 2 days later, on Wednesday, eventually, out of the blue, somebody said, on Tuesday, somebody said, I should speak to the accountant. I called the accountant on the phone. I pretended to cry. I said, see, my vendors are unhappy with me. I am a small girl in this business. I just started. I'm begging you, please give me my money. What you are owing me is small. You guys are a multi-billion dollar organization. You can afford it. And if, even though I know how these things are, my vendors will not believe me. They will think I've been paid and I'm holding to the money, and they will blacklist me and make and spoil my name. You guys are big. There's no lawyer I want. You know, I was just telling her, there's no lawyer I want to call. You guys cannot call somebody bigger. I'm just begging. I'm begging. Please. This is important to me. I'm very small. I know I'm small. People are big. You can finish me. Just give me this money. I'm begging. I'm begging. Then they say, Madam, calm down. Madam, calm down. It's not like that. Don't worry. On my honor. You know, I didn't go the high road. I felt that God wanted me to take the low road. And that's what I did. And by Wednesday, my money was paid in full. I spare you some other intricate details of some email that was going left and right. For every time they send a mail, and by the way, we noticed this wasn't properly done, I will reply, oh, well, on that day, we worked with the executive. I kept, you know, responding to the mail with politeness, with courtesy, thanking them for the opportunity, but insisting that they made promises and were guaranteed that as such an establishment with lofty reputation will hold true, you know, to their promises. I just kept going the low road. Now, I may not do this tomorrow, but this instance, this was the scripture that came, and this was how the Holy Spirit interpreted this scripture in that instance. Now, this is the rest of what I want to say. Number two, I will not say that because the scripture applied to that situation that way, that the next time I have an instance, I won't go and ask God. He'll probably give me another scripture, probably give me another interpretation. Another time he may tell me, no, go there like a boss and go there controlling things. Tell them if they don't do it your way, you know, your way or the highway. That's what working with God is. You don't make assumptions. The third thing I want to say is learn the Logos. Learn the Logos. Memorize scripture. Familiarize yourself with it. It becomes easy for the Holy Spirit to tell you which one to use. It's like maybe there are 6 or 7 tools and you know all of them. When you are faced with an instance, you will know which one to bring out of your arsenal. It increases the probability, you know, of success because you are skilled, right? So please, I beg you, learn the Logos. Learn it. When you learn it, it becomes easy for you to know what is Rhema in a particular situation. Number four, right? Everyday application of scripture is available for everyday people in everyday circumstances. And this is one reason why I feel God wants me to be doing the snack verse. You know when preachers preach, at the back of your mind, you feel like they are special. Right? These ones, they are anointed. I've heard people say it. I beg your pardon. I've heard people say that they are anointed. They are special. God answers them. I'm an everyday person. I'm as anointed as the next child of God. I have a family to cater to. I have children to take care of. I have a home to run. I have a business to run. And I'm female, right? So if you think that maybe because you are female, I'm a female, so remove that alternative. If you think because you are busy, because you've got a family, I've got a family too, knock out that excuse. If you think because you are not a preacher, in the sense that you don't head a church, you are not a man of God, prophet, apostle, pastor, knock out that excuse. The word of God is available to give everyday people everyday solutions to everyday problems. And that's why I told this story. So that if you take your time to learn the Logos, it becomes easy for you to get the Rhema for a specific situation. I'll take the four things again. Number one, this letter is Paul's letter to the Romans. He's telling Christians how to treat Christians. This is what the scriptures say to everybody in every situation at every time, for every person that is a child of God. Number two, I had a unique experience, and I was able to receive the leading and the voice of God to solve that problem in a real life situation that produced results for me. And it has increased my confidence in God's ability to solve my problem. It has increased my confidence in my ability to hear God. It has increased my dependence on the Word of God as a guaranteed way of finding uncommon wisdom. in situations, right? Number three, there is everyday application of God's word for everyday people in everyday circumstances. Number four, understand and learn the logos. The rhema will come to you. Praise the Lord. Do you have any questions or any comments about my story? Or do you have a similar story to tell about when God's word came through for you in a way that is consistent with the logos, but it was an applicable rhema for a unique situation? I'd love to hear from you. God bless you.